2,000 new cases today, the most we've seen in one day. Total cases in the state now over 77,000, and deaths from the virus sitting at more than 2,700. And looking at South Carolina, the state saw 1,300 new cases today. It's about 200 fewer cases than yesterday, which was a record for the state. Total cases now over 33,000. South Carolina DHEC also reports deaths sitting at over 700. While some churches in our area looked forward to reopening in-person services after coronavirus cases started to level off. But now, as the opposite is happening, it's leaving them with some tough decisions. Tradisha Wooder talked with churches on both sides of the river.
As COVID cases continue to increase across our area, some of our churches are questioning if they should keep holding services. Some haven't opened their doors yet in the first place, and others are waiting out just to see how bad things get.
As cases continue to break daily records across the two states, some churches are continuing to hold off in-person services.
We've been looking at the numbers.
Bishop T.L. Reddick is the pastor of Break Free Christian Worship Covenant. He says he's watching the numbers closely before making the decision to reopen. And if the latest spike tells him anything, it's that maybe now it's not the safest time.
We want to open our doors as soon as possible, but we're going to be as cautious as possible as well.
But others, like the New Passion Church, have already opened their doors. Pastor Nick Karn says they're operating under 30% capacity, but he says they're always watching to see if there needs to be any adjustment.
If we feel like our people are at risk or in danger, where we see it going so high that it could be a hindrance to our community, we would make changes based on that.
Over in North Augusta, Dr. Stephen Cudgett says their doors will remain closed until further notice.
I continue to tell our folks that the safest place for them to worship and socially distance during this time is at home.
He says he's confident things will get better and has decided to look on the bright side of a very dark situation.
I think this has been a great opportunity for the church to be disrupted in a positive way and to really reevaluate what is important and how are we going to continue to accomplish the mission that we have as an organization.
And many churches say even though they've had to shut their doors to do in-person services, their outreach to the community and across the world are at the highest point they've ever seen it.
All right, thanks for that report, Tradisha. Looking at our local hospitals now, as of what?
95, another warm one on Tuesday. We'll keep the highs into the 90s, but it looks like rain chances actually go up headed into the 4th of July holiday.
Well, the pandemic is forcing a lot of change in the wedding planning world. We'll show you how both the industry and newlyweds are adapting. But first, take a look at your screen. We're going to show you your lottery numbers from this evening. And if you don't play the lottery, you can just look at the fishes from the Baltimore Aquarium Tropical Fish Cam.
Near Past Services.
Well, we're at the end of June, which is normally the peak of wedding season. Obviously, this year, things are looking a lot different. The pandemic causing cancellations, reschedulings, and last-minute plans. But as Tom Foreman shows us, love always finds a way.
They knew that they both loved the Wedding Crashers, knew what her dress looked like, which colors they'd use. Kelsey Gibson and Alex Ferreira knew they were going to have a perfect wedding. Then, in the Michigan cold, the worst crasher of all came calling.
It's so crazy. We would have never thought that this would ever happen.
The pandemic swept away the pomp, the party, and the promise of 200 guests sharing their special moment.
And then there came the day when the honeymoon got canceled. I mean, it kept progressing as, like, one item, like, dominoes falling.
They're not alone. Spring kicks off the wedding season each year in a big way. But not this time, according to a leading matrimonial website, TheKnot.com.
As we look at data, there were supposed to be a little over 500,000 weddings over the course of the last 3 months. So tons of couples are rescheduling their weddings, getting married, you know, maybe virtually, and postponing their reception for later.
The Knot estimates the average couple employs more than a dozen vendors, dressmakers, florists, photographers, caterers, limo drivers, many of whom rely on the wedding trade. So the industry is clawing its way back, embracing new tongue-in-cheek ideas like delay the date notices, and supporting small private services while awaiting the return of big celebrations.
We are seeing what we're calling the mini-money right now. Bakeries are sending mini wedding cakes. Florists are sending mini bouquets or maybe some centerpieces that the couple can enjoy.
As for Alex and Kelsey, as his company started making masks and she dove into her work in public health,
we talked to our families about it. We talked to our friends.
They loaded up a few close friends, some strict disinfecting rules, and their puppy, drove to a lakeshore, and got married anyway while their families watched online. The virus made their big reception wait, but not their love. And
our wedding was perfect in spite of the circumstances.
Our wedding was absolutely perfect, even though it wasn't planned.
Oh, congrats to those two. What a great story. And our local wedding planning businesses say they're seeing a new wave of displaced brides who are rushing to make new plans. One business said they had 15 brides reach out to them in just the last week to put together bridal showers. Chris?
We had a few showers out there earlier today.